Hello everyone, welcome back. As promised, I said I would be watching this tonight, and, well, we've now seen it, or I've now seen it. It is 1:18 in the morning. I have no idea how long this video is going to be, so it may be semi-long, maybe long, no idea. There's some stuff to talk about, but nowhere near as much as I had to talk about for the film, so I'm gonna do my usual shit, so be prepared. Usual disclaimers are going to apply. This is not a full or detailed review. This is a ramble, discussion, opinion-style video where I just kind of waffle on about what I watched and give my opinions on what I watched and the experience I had while watching it. That's pretty much the gist. Expect me to possibly forget things, repeat myself, and various other normal crap, and say a lot, because... in the comments, in the description below, there will be a link to my AniList and a link to my Twitter. On AniList, you can see any and all of my anime stats, what I've watched, the ratings I've given, and notes, and various other things. Normally, I do an AniList entry. Fat Man Moo has appeared on the screen. One moment while I close Steam. Alright, I have returned. Sorry about that. Normally, I make an AniList entry the moment after I finish the anime, and then I make a video. There was one exception where I wanted to talk about it so bad that I had to do the video first before doing the AniList entry. I can't rightfully make an AniList entry for this yet. Girls in Panzer Das Finale is on AniList. It's weird. So it is categorized as a film. And it's the first part of a 6-part long film series. However, on AniList, the reason I can't set it up yet is because, or I'm not sure how to set it up yet, is because AniList says, if you click on it, the description states that it is the first part. However, when you try to add it to your list, it allows you to pick up to 6 completed episodes, meaning AniList is treating it like a normal series. Therefore, setting it as completed is technically not accurate because you haven't completed it, because there's still 5 episodes that aren't out of it yet, if you know what I mean. And that messes with my OCD a lot. I didn't expect that to be a thing. I thought it was just a movie, and then when part 2 came out, that would be a separate entry. Apparently not. So I'm gonna have to mess around with that for a little bit. When I get the time. It'll be after this video, obviously, but I'll try to get it up. So I can't make an accurate rating. And this is a problem for me because, oh man, I can't make it. Damn, freaking can't make it. It's so weird, but I can't make an accurate rating for this now. To briefly go over the ratings that I gave to the previous Girls in Panzer stuff, I've rewatched the series. That's a 7.9 rating. The Anzio OVA has a 8.0 rating. The film I gave a 9.0 rating, and the film OVA I gave a 6.6 rating. This I was planning based on what I had seen and based on what in my brain I would have expected to put it. I was thinking somewhere between 8.0 and 9.0, so somewhere in that margin. But see, I can't accurately rate it because there's 5 parts I haven't seen. Therefore, it wouldn't make sense to put it at like an 8.9 for the first part, and then, because then what if part 2 comes out and I either dislike it more or I like it more? Then that's going to affect the rating, and you can't on AniList. I use the advanced rating system, and you can't reset the advanced list, or excuse me, the advanced rating, unless you delete your entry and start over again. There you go. 4 minutes have been spent talking about shit that has nothing to do with the movie itself. I'm going to get this right out of the gates. I did not like this film as much as the film. So Das Finale Part 1 is not... I didn't like it as much as the film. That's not to say I disliked it. I still liked it far more than the main series and the Anzio OVA and stuff. It is still extremely good. Oh, man, I had so much fun watching this again. And that's so... That's... Damn it. So a lot of the same things that I said about the film apply here. Because, for example, suspense. Again, on the edge of my seat during the tank battle, just... I'm like, oh... It's... And holy shit. Guys, there's something that they did in this anime, a particular tank that they introduce in this film. With this anime shit, fuck off. There's a certain tank they introduce with this film that gave me such an erection that I am inclined to say that this is the best tank in the entire series. I'm sure most of you that have seen the film are going to know exactly what I'm talking about. But you may... I'm thinking that those of you that have seen this are thinking about said tank, and I think you're all thinking of the wrong tank. So, it might seem obvious, but I'm not talking about that tank. I'm talking about a different tank. The premise for this film, and I'm guessing the premise for the entire series, the six-part series, is essentially... Okay, no, first of all, I gotta say, everything's changed. Like, characters aren't in the same positions they were before. Like, for example, there's a new president and vice president. Two of the main cast have taken over for that. That's weird. It's going to take a long time for me to adapt to that. Miho's not the commander, at least as of now. That luxury has been given to one of the other characters. And this is the whole premise of the show, by the way, this other character. Because apparently she didn't get accepted into a university or something along those lines. And so I wasn't exactly listening, I guess, because I'm kind of still a little confused on it. But they keep saying that she's going to repeat a year, but she denies that she'll repeat a year or something like that. And so they're taking part in this tournament, and she's going to be, they made her the commander because so that she can get credit for it, I guess, which I guess would allow her to be accepted into a university. Is that what's going on? Please clear it up. Either tell me that that's what's going on, or correct me so that I understand fully what the premise actually is of the show in the comments section. That would be much appreciated. So there you go. So yeah, Mio's not the freaking commander, and that's weird as hell. There's a scene as well where Maho is talking with, her second in command. I don't remember. It's like Erika or something like that is her name. Where she's now the commander, so Maho's not a commander anymore, I guess. It's so weird. Everything's changing. But I don't know. It's really weird to say the film, because I'm talking about this film, but I'm also going to be referring to Girls in Panzer, the film. So I'm trying to figure out what I should call this. I guess we'll just call this Das Finale. Then, in this particular film, it starts off similar to the film, where the first, it just, when it starts, it shoots you straight into the action. However, back then, in the other film, in the main film, that was a little different because it started there and that's where it actually started. In this, it starts during a battle, and then it goes back in time, leading up to the events that will then take us back to the opening scene. But the opening scene is like, there's just explosions everywhere, there's wood shards flying everywhere, and everything's going shit, and it looks amazing. And it's one of those moments where it's like, holy fuck, they're getting their asses handed to them, I guess. I can't wait to see more. That's basically the start, and I kind of already talked about the premise of the thing. So they're taking part in another tournament, which is great. It's so good to see a tournament come back. So flag tanks have made a return. It's not the case of Annihilation like the film was like, even though I'd prefer Annihilation, honestly. I already explained why I like Annihilation more. And the first school that they're fighting is the BC Freedom Academy. So it's an entirely new school that we've never, at least as far as I'm aware, I've never seen before. And these guys are quite possibly the best school in the entire fucking series. We'll talk about why. So it looks like it's going to be a typical old tournament. You see all of the characters pretty much from all of the different schools, including the Finnish school that was introduced in the film. Some people told me about that in the comments when I was asking about like the BT-42, because I knew that it was Finnish. I knew that the whole spiel was that it was Finnish, and the BT-42 is a Finnish modified tank, so okay, even though there's only three girls, you know, you don't see any others. They appear in the show for a minute. And there's no... I was... you know, Katusha shows up, of course, Pravda School, and of course Maho makes an appearance and such. So, and the Saunders School makes an appearance. So obviously everybody's back together again, or back to where they should be. It's not like everybody's still on the same team like they were before. So everybody's retransferred back to their main schools. But there's I guess I should get one of my disappointments out of the way right away. AniList didn't make an appearance. I was really hoping, after seeing the film, I was really hoping that the Das Finale was going to have AniList in it. But this is a 6-part series. We're only with part one. The next 5 parts aren't out yet. And AniList does appear in the introduction sequence, the opening. So she's obviously going to appear at some point in the series. Therefore, I look forward to that because I really hope we get to see her command another tank. Maybe we're going to fight against them again or something. I don't know. That'd be really nice to see, though. The first half of the film is focused on leading up to the tournament, but it's not boring. It's really fun because I think a good chunk of time is spent. They end up locating, because in order to join the tournament, they needed another tank. Excuse me. So they had to go and look for one. And they actually detected a new tank that they didn't know about before in the depths of the freaking aircraft carrier. It's not an aircraft carrier. In the fucking ship that they're sitting on. The school ship, I guess we'll call it. A glorified aircraft carrier. And so they go into the depths. And we've seen them go into the depths of the ship before, but not like this. There is literally a whole community in the depths. It's like the slums. It's really gross looking. Everybody's shady looking. But they come into this bar. And it's a really cool scene. I think the whole bar scene is so much fun to watch. We meet this new group of characters. We're all... They talk in like pirate speak, and they just want to sail ships, and you know, they're drinking rum and shit. You know, it's a really amusing scene, and I think a bar fight ensues, and it's so much fun to watch how each of the characters just, I don't know, there's like the most tense thumb fight you'll ever see in your life that happens. And I love the part, they didn't bring any attention to it, but there's a moment where they're about to start kicking each other's asses. Like, they back the main characters into a corner. and they all pull out weapons. Like, there's a knife, like a pink knife. And it's like, holy shit, this is getting violent. And for a moment, for a split second... what is her name? Yukari, she pulls out a fucking hand grenade behind her back. Did nobody see that? Does nobody know that she's just carrying around a fucking hand grenade? What? What? Thankfully, they stop the fight. Thankfully, their captain gets in on everything and stops the fight before a grenade is launched. Oh my god, that was really, really... I couldn't stop laughing. So it's good to see that this film does bring out the laughs a little bit there. Anyways, so after a bit of dialogue, they end up talking about tanks, you know, because they're looking for a tank, and of course, this whole new group of characters has no fucking clue what they're talking about, and they're talking about land ship, and I'm like, well, they're talking in pirate speak, they like to sail ships, obviously land ship is just what they call tanks, but I didn't realize that they're actually talking about a land ship unintentionally. They didn't know that it was a tank, but yes, there is a land ship. They introduce a whole bunch of new tanks in the first part of this, and the one that they end up adding to their team is so bizarre. It's a Mark IV. It's a World War I tank. Now, you don't know this at first, other than hearing the term land ship. Because they show it, it's like it was steaming their food. It was really weird. But they don't actually show it. You just get to see, like, the ass end of it. And then, of course, it gets worked on back up top, and you still don't get to see it. You don't actually get to see it until the battle starts, until the match starts. So they go, they get into the first match, or they're about to get in the first match. There was another infiltration operation where, of course, they infiltrated the school to see what they're going to be up against. They've done this pretty much throughout the entire series. But this time, it's a little more unique. So they find that the BC Freedom Academy seems to be split in two. The The students seem to be split in two, so they're fighting, they're constantly fighting among each other. And this gimmick is played up until the battle starts. You even see their tanks grinding against each other while they're coming up to prepare for the beginning of the match. And so both our characters and you as a viewer are led to believe that they are going to be, you know, they're not going to have good cooperation, and they're going to be easy, they're going to be discoordinated, and they're going to be easy to take down. Of course, the plot twist, which, by the way, there will be spoilers in this video, the plot twist is that they are very coordinated, and it was all just a ploy, and it worked. And so you get to see the ass end of that as it starts to kick everyone's ass. And it's so funny because the new team, Shark Team, which has joined the school with their new landship, the Mark IV, is... We get to see a whole new cast of characters, a whole new group of characters come in, and they're all very... They've all got unique personalities, so I absolutely love that. But it's such a funny scene. See, I still didn't know what... I didn't know they were talking about an actual landship, right? So when it comes rolling over the hill, on the first time it's revealed, at first you see the sail, you see the fucking flag, and, like, the fake mast, and I'm like, what the fuck is this? And it comes rolling over the hill. And I couldn't stop laughing again. It was so... It's like, you've got to be fucking kidding me. It's actually a landship. That is crazy. What the hell is that going to fucking do? Well, it actually proves to be very useful. Anyways, so you can obviously tell that the character that's playing the commander now, which in the place of Miho, is having a very tough time. And wouldn't you? Now, I hate being the leader. I have never liked being the leader. I have never liked being the one to give out orders. I prefer to follow someone else's orders, depending on the circumstances. So in video games, for example, when I'm playing in a squad, like, for example, War Thunder, I don't ever like to be the one to make any of the decisions. I usually just, even if I have to run the squad and be the host of the squad, I'm still never the one who makes the decisions. It's always up to my squad mates. And if they don't want to make the decision either, then we're going to have a stalemate because I don't like to make decisions. And it's the same thing. There's no way I could sit there and give out orders. Like, if I had to be... If this tank sport existed, right? Which, my God, please, somebody has to work on making this a reality. And I was part of a crew, I would not be the commander. If I would be part of the commander's crew, I would be anything else, except maybe a radio operator, because that sounds extremely stressful. Oh, that'd be so overwhelming. But I guess I should get on to some of the new vehicles that they introduced. There's a scene at the very beginning of the film that they show freaking Goliaths, which that was really funny. They're using the Goliaths to detect where the tank is in the ship. Goliaths were, like, a complete failure, but it's funny to see all these complete failures get used in the show for useful things. Goliaths were, as far as I know, they were like a German rolling bomb, essentially. They were just a tiny remote-controlled, usually, I think they were controlled by wire, actually, remote-controlled little mini tank that had explosives on board, and it would drive, I guess the idea was it was supposed to drive underneath tanks and detonate to destroy or disable vehicles, but as far as I know, they weren't successful at all. So, you know, in the BC, this BC Freedom Academy is, I said earlier that they are quite possibly the best school. Now, they have three new tanks that have not been seen in the show previously, as far as I know, and they're all French tanks. First of all, I think one of them is a Renault FT, which is another World War I tank. Curious. That's actually their flag tank during the match. But the other two tanks, they have S-35s, which are boring. But then, oh, here's the tank I was talking about, guys. No, I wasn't talking about the Mark IV like some of you probably thought I was. They introduce one of my all-time favorite vehicles, hands down, the ARL-44. And this team's got four of them. massive boner time. I love the ARL 44 so much, and I was so happy when it was put in War Thunder. My reaction to seeing the ARL 44 in War Thunder was I was just through the roof, and I still haven't played it once because I'm scared to play one of my favorite tanks. You do not understand. You would not understand how much I was excited to see the ARL 44. Because at first, when they show the tanks from a bird's eye view of BC, they don't show them up close, but you look down on them and you could see them grinding each other. And I'm like, wait a minute, is that an ARL 44? No, go back. Is that an ARL 44? And I started to get super excited, and sure enough, it's an ARL 44. Four of them. Oh, right, I was looking at my notes, and I was like, what the fuck was that? I didn't spell something right, apparently. Lying is what I spell instead of lighting. And that's, I guess that's something I should talk about. The improvements to... Actually, you know what? No, I'm not going to talk about that. I'll talk about that here in a little bit. Yeah, we talked about the ARL 44. We talked about the new tanks that were shown here. Another detail that I really liked is throughout the series they've been using like various World War II things in the background, not during battles. You know, as usual or as normal utilities, I guess. Like for example, I think in the film, I didn't mention this in my video, but in the film they actually use a Japanese bomber as a reconnaissance aircraft to keep an eye on the battle. That was super cool. In this, there's actually multiple, and also another thing that I never picked up on this, actually, until I watched this. But the big screens that the audience watch the matches on is basically a railgun, but without the gun. It's just a big screen. It's like they took the gun off the railgun and put a big screen on it, and that's what it is. I never fucking picked up on that until I saw it in the background during this film. So that's really cool. And I think that they also use an AA gun in this. They shoot it up in the air, I guess, to announce the start of a match or something like that. And that was really cool. And there's more planes. They have more reconnaissance planes in here, but they also have like these fighter aircraft, these prop fighter aircraft that show up that with smoke, colored smoke. I couldn't place my finger on what these planes were. They looked like ME-209s. Which would be really weird, but I still don't know. If anybody knows exactly what type of plane that is, feel free to let me know in the comments below. Okay, I guess before I talk about some of the things I liked and didn't like about the film, or the improvements, and there's only one thing I actually didn't like, but we'll get to that at the end, I think. They sent the Tiger P out for scouting. What a weird tank to send out for scouting. They probably wouldn't have gotten to the shitty position they got into if they didn't send the Tiger P out for scouting. I mean, come on. I know it's got a fast and badass engine and can maneuver really well in the show, but you don't send a Tiger P for reconnaissance, man. Ugh, whatever. There, the best scene, without a doubt, in my opinion, in the entire film is the one near the end where they're all of our characters are just trapped on this bridge. They try to cross this bridge, and that's where it's revealed that the BC school is actually very coordinated. And they lured them into a trap, and this bridge is like this rickety old wooden piece of shit. I don't even know how that bridge would collapse if you tried to walk across it, let alone put a shitload of tanks on it, including a fucking Mark IV. Anyways, They shoot out the freaking front part of the bridge so they can't get all the way across, and then they shoot out the rear end so they're trapped on this bridge. Dude, that's got to be dangerous. Like you there's got to be some regulations in these tournaments, right? Because I've already talked about how they have this special protection from their tanks to protect their tanks and the crew from shells. Yet people are still sticking their heads out of the hatches. Oh, they rarely get hit. Who gives a shit? If you get hit by a shell, can you imagine Miho sticking out of her fucking Panzer IV? And there's shells flying around and the crew's inside doing their thing? What happens if Miho gets struck by a big-ass shell? Her entire upper part of her body's gonna get sliced right off, and guts are gonna spray around and flap, you know, it's fucking, the loader's gonna look up and there's gonna be an intestine slap across her face. That's, it's like nobody gives a shit that it's really dangerous. And my point to this whole discussion right here is that if the bridge falls, the tanks and their crew will fall too. And sure, they're inside of a tank, but there are no seat belts in tanks, and the interior of a tank is completely metal, sharp, and jagged. They will smash their faces into a corner bit and gouge out an eyeball. Like, nobody thinks about these things. Maybe I'm thinking too deep into it. Maybe I'm getting a little bit too violent. I don't know. This is what happens when you watch too much Higurashi. Anyways. This scene is really good. The destruction effects are... oh, they're so freaking good. It's pretty much the film, but slightly better. Watching shells whiz by and ricochet off tanks, and watching, you know, the bridge get struck, and, you know, there's just this plume of smoke and dust, and shards of wood fly everywhere, and logs fall from the bridge. It's really, really, really good looking. And all of the explosions and everything, they basically took the film, the experiences they learned from the film, and they used those experiences in the making of this. So it looks very high quality in the animation department once again. So that's really freaking good. Now let's talk about, I guess I talked about animation, so we might as well, before I talk about the ending, we might as well talk about the improvements that they made. So I don't really think the animation is better than the film. I think it looks relatively the same. Now, there was far more tanks in the movie, so that might be why I don't think it. But I don't think the animation is necessarily better. But what is very better? That's not... what is a lot better is the lighting and the actual textures on the tanks. The lighting, the reflections, it looks a lot more metal. It looks a lot more natural and more realistic. So they obviously did something with the visuals of the tanks that is vastly improved over the base series and the film and any of the OVAs. So that's definitely vastly improved. So tanks look better. And here's the thing that I dislike. I don't know if anybody was going to pick up on this after I talked about it in the film, but one of the and it's nitpicky, so don't worry, it's not like some big thing. It's very nitpicky, but in the film, one of the negativities I gave to it was in two particular scenes, for half a second each, you can see a 3D character model. And I said it stuck out like a sore thumb, that's why I noticed it right away. And I went into a discussion as to why I don't like 3D models in anime like this. 3D character models, I'm talking. Of course, the tanks are CG. I don't like CG characters. The Das Finale does it literally so much that every fucking scene with a tank has somebody that is three-dimensional. And it looks like we're playing a PlayStation 1 video game. It happens, in fact, if you want to see it for yourself, if you never picked up on it, or it doesn't bother you, obviously it doesn't matter, but if you never picked up on it and you want to see exactly what I'm talking about, open up the film, open up Das Finale, and go literally the first like 30 seconds of the film, you will see the scene where we're looking through the optics and it's panning around, and you'll see the first thing you see is Miho's tank, and you'll see her look right and then look left. If you look at that, she looks like a PlayStation 1 player model. Just look at it. And it sticks out so much and it looks so goddamn ugly. Unfortunately, they do it so much in this goddamn film. They do it with the main characters from time to time, and they do it with the characters of the enemy tanks. There's even a moment late where I think it's the FT crew. I guess the commander of the FT is sticking out of the tank, or is sitting behind it, sticking out of one of the hatches, and they shoot and start driving, and her character flies back and then leans forward, and it looks so bad because she's got a 3D model. It's so ugly. I don't know if I must be the only person that doesn't like that, because I have seen nobody else complain about it in my comment section or agree with me. So I'm probably in the minority on this, but when I didn't like it in the film, and it only happened two times there that I noticed, and for those two times it was like really, really short, only a couple seconds, and then in this they do it over and over again and it lasts for more, and it's up close too, like that Miho scene is right in your goddamn face. Also, I guess I should talk about one other thing. So that's a negative. That's pretty much the only thing I didn't like too much. So it's pretty much good everywhere else. There's a really amusing scene as well when they first go into the slums part of the ship, and they're chasing, because that one of one of the characters gets basically kidnapped, and they're chasing after them, and it's in a first person view. It's in a first person view, and they go and they jump down this pole, and it's a really amusing scene. It's almost lewd. But they're coming down the pole, and the fucking Miho is coming down so fast her ass literally is in your face on screen. It's not an upskirt shot, but it might as well be. I just thought that was really amusing. I didn't expect that at all. And then it shows an external view of each character's asses piling up on each other's heads. It's like, oh my god, that'd be so fucking awkward. I wouldn't know what the hell I would be thinking at that point. Thank god it's a girls-only school. Because otherwise there'd be some lumps. That's pretty much it that I wrote down, other than the ending. I guess this won't be a very long thoughts video, but let's talk about the ending then. The ending, after they end up actually getting off the bridge, so, and they use the Mark IV to create essentially an extension on the bridge so that the rest of the tanks can get down safely. And once BC realizes that they've been foiled, after having foiled the main characters, they start to retreat. And they're all retreating, they all gather up and they're all retreating. And I guess we're left to assume that our characters are in pursuit. But this is where the end happens. It ends on a cliffhanger. You don't even get to finish the first match, which is a little disappointing. I didn't actually expect that. I was told that it kind of ends on a cliffhanger, but I was actually expecting it to end, like, on a different type of cliffhanger. I didn't know it was going to end mid-match. That's what I wasn't expecting. But regardless, the very ending scene is BC Academy singing kind of like a musical note. It's very akin to the Katusha musical note. In fact, all the tanks are kind of lined up in a similar way, driving, and they're all just sitting there, sticking out of their hatches, singing. I don't know what they're singing about, onions or something. I don't fucking know. I wasn't reading the subtitles. I was listening. So that was really nice. And then it's pretty much after that it ends. And now, seeing that this came out in December 2017, are we going to have to wait 6 fucking years for this thing to finish? Because if the last one came, if this part came out in December 2017, we're about to hit... We're closing in on December 2018, and we still haven't gotten part 2. And from what I've also been told, it takes a while for translation to happen, official translation to happen for each part, for this part at least. So that's probably going to be the same deal with the rest. We're going to be sitting around, we'll have white, gray beards by the time fucking the 6th part is released. And that's really, really depressing, because I want to see more of this, and it sucks that I have to wait so goddamn long to see more of it, especially when it ends on a cliffhanger like that. Now, I'm going to assume that the rest of the episodes are going to focus on tank battles. I'm assuming there's pretty much a majority of the 5 remaining episodes are going to be just nothing but tank battles. The reason I say that is because they're in a tournament, they've just started, and they didn't even finish the first match in the first episode. So I'm guessing by episode 2, we'll probably see the end of the first match, and we'll see the beginning of the second match, and possibly the entire second match, and then it'll end, and then episode 3, we'll see another match, and then episode 4, we'll see another match, etc., etc. Unless they do something like they did here, where in the next part, we'll see the end of the first match and the beginning of the second match, then it'll end on a cliffhanger again, and vice, you know, and so on, and so on, and so on, right? I don't exactly know how they're planning to do it, but I do want to see more. Like I said, it's a great film, but I still don't think it's as good as the main film, as the actual film. I think there was a lot more to going on there. I mean, it was 2 hours, though. This is like 40 minutes, so this is classified as a film. So, and there's so many good scenes in the film that just aren't here. Like, there is no Russian sacrifice scene or anything like that. And one thing I will give the Das Finale is that there is no depressing shit that makes me cry. There's no piano music playing over a ship leaving and everybody crying. There's none of that shit. Thank God. So there's a thumbs up for you. So that's pretty much it, guys. There's nothing else to really talk about. I pretty much covered, I think, the basis of everything I wanted to talk about. Thoroughly enjoyed it. Absolutely loved it. And I would rewatch this again, without a doubt. And the only disappointing thing is that now we gotta sit and we gotta wait. And waiting isn't fun. When it comes to other Girls in Panzer stuff I have to cover, I'm actually done. Now, except for the specials, like the extra OVAs and such. So when it comes to that, I don't know when I'm going to get to those. Because I still don't have anywhere that I've located to watch them until I can actually purchase them in a collection that they have. The only unfortunate thing is that some of them don't come in the collection, so some of them you have to buy the Blu-ray of, like, the main series, and we're talking very expensive by that point. And as for... So probably this is going to be it for Girls in Panzer content for at least a little while. I've caught up, mostly. But there is going to be something else. For those of you that may not have watched my previous anime thoughts and opinions videos, you may not know this, but now that I have seen the film... And now that I've finished what I'm doing, I am actually going to be purchasing the Girls in Panzer video game. I think Dream Tank Match it's called, or something like that. I've heard that it has pretty high ratings, and from the trailers, it looks like a shit ton of fun. And I really want to play it, and I really want to LP it. So if you want to see more Girls in Panzer content from me, there'll be an LP of that game coming whenever I'm able to get it. Hopefully at the end of the month, but it may take a week or two to actually show up at my door, since I have to order it from overseas. Anyways, guys, feel free to post your own opinions on Das Finale in the comments below, and I will see you in the next anime thoughts and opinions video. Don't forget that you can also recommend and suggest any anime that you want, and it'll be added to the list. In case you're wondering how I'm going to be doing this, the list that I have here has a shitload of anime on it. I'm going to maneuver towards Higurashi, probably, but when it comes to picking on here, a lot of people want me to watch the anime they've recommended. I'm not going to just be picking. I'm actually going to randomly choose using dice. So that's going to determine what anime I watch next. So if you have recommended or suggested an anime, you're going to have to wait and hope that fate decides for me to watch that anime. So I may watch your anime soon. I may watch it in a while. We'll just have to wait and see. Thanks so much for watching, guys. I'll see you guys in the next video. I feel like there was something I was forgetting to say. I don't know. I really want to play War Thunder now. Maybe I'll finally try the ARL-44.